I was going to get excited about seeing Zach Holy Paladin against Rub Cub Holy Paladin, but apparently Zach is a demon hunter and Rub Cub's abandoned the light and now a restoration druid. Let's see if he's prepared it enough to go toe-to-toe with Kolo, who has been playing druid for quite some time now. With this demon hunter death knight composition, as we pointed out in the pregame, they're quite durable before dampening with their own self-healing mechanics through Deathstrike and Leech. So the rejects are going to have to hammer through that with heavy single target damage. Currently, you don't see a lot of teams targeting the Death Knights before dampening because of Deathstrike, and usually they will go after the Demon Hunter. In this position, the rejects appear to be attacking the Death Knight, and I think that's a mistake. Kolo already taking advantage of drinking in this specific matchup, and I mean, if you've got an opportunity to do it, even if it's 10%, that's 10% more that you didn't have before. Rub Cub even, any opportunity, keeps a heal over time effects onto his team and consistently tries to regenerate that mana as it is expected for this game to go into dampening.
I like what Valido did there, just traded out the anti-magic zone for Jamili's Icy Veins, just really try to prevent some of that Frost Mage damage, especially early on. I think without dampening, the rejects is going to have a very difficult time actually closing out the game. Zach and Valido, they're just way too durable on these classes. And unless Rub Cub's pushing in and getting crowd control on Cole, and they're actually trying to crowd control him, I just don't think they're going to be able to break through that Restoration Druid healing initially. Rub Cub already falling way behind on mana. Cole really intelligently just sitting down for the drinks as often as possible, consistently. Jamili just trying to keep up the pressure. Seth Curry playing bodyguard for Jamili in this game, trying to deflect Valido and Zach, but the rejects, they just don't have any pressure.
I do suppose attacking the Death Knight before dampening means that he has to commit his runic power, so his resource to deal normally damage instead to heal and sustain himself, which means the rejects can reduce the damage they take by attacking the Death Knight. But before dampening, I really don't see any opportunities for them to kill him. Jamili has committed an assault here with the Frozen Orb and not even phased the team of Never Lucky. Kolo definitely prepared in this matchup, dishing out tons of healing. Rub Cub looking to sit down and regenerate mana, and Kolo has now finally taken responsibility for denying that. Obviously, as the Death Knight Demon Hunter, their main objective is to burn Rub Cub's mana bar, find a kill when he can no longer heal, and it's up to Kolo to really deny Rub Cub from finding those opportunities as frequently as possible.
Yeah, Kolo is Rub Cub's babysitter. You can see Seth Curry trying to help Rub Cub escape and get some mana back, but Kolo really trying to shut that down and slow it down. What I noticed Never Lucky's doing, Valido actually death gripped in Rub Cub, and Zach landed a mana rift, so that's something they're going to be looking to set up throughout this game, and it's one of the reasons why Rub Cub is far behind on mana. At this point, Kolo still sitting pretty at around 100% mana, Rub Cub already down to 50%, and if Valido and Zach, they can keep up this pressure, continuously look for mana rifts, and Kolo can shut down the drinks. Once again, you can see him crossing the map. He's chasing Rub Cub, preventing him from drinking. I feel like Never Lucky, they have the winning composition.
One thing that's impressive to me on the side of Never Lucky is a player like Zach, who's still a young guy and he's just started in the tournament scene, is also now flexing on both the healer role and the DPS role, and he's diversified himself quite far as opposed to some of the most veteran players who are still kind of stuck on one class. And if he can even pick up Demon Hunter this rapidly for his team and pull off victories against the likes of the rejects, Never Lucky is easily a top contender, and currently there has been absolutely no pressure from the rejects, no opportunities that I've seen for them to really get anything going. Never Lucky have them completely destroyed on both defense and offense, and it's almost just an inevitability for Rub Cub to ultimately run out of mana so long as they can keep denying his drinks. Never Lucky should be walking away with this first game, and the rejects need a better composition.
What I really feel like needs to happen is Seth Curry needs to have some pressure on the Kolo, and right now he's attacking him, but this isn't the pressure I'm looking for. I don't want him to just sit on Kolo. I want them to look for the paralysis, the bash, and the leg sweep swaps on Kolo. And when Jamili has his damage ready with the Frozen Orb, the Comet Storm, the Ice Nova, that's an opportunity for them to really try to pressure Kolo down, make swaps to him, because they are not denting Valido. They are not denting Zach in this matchup. Kolo is easily healing through it. Right now, Rub Cub once again going for a drink, and now they play tag. Zach's like, okay, you're going to sit on my healer. Well, I'm going to sit on yours. We're winning on mana. This is just a great strategy from Never Lucky, and the rejects, they have to try to find an opening.
Yep, Mana Rift, I believe, is selected here by Zach, so he can get that advantage even further by every time he stuns Rub Cup, he can activate Mana Rift to guarantee that it lands and removes some remainder of mana from Rub Cup. Rub Cup's main objective right now is to run laps around the arena and try to sit down and drink so that at least in dampening, he can have mana to heal his team, which is required to kill the durability of Death Knights and Demon Hunters to an extent with their self-sufficiency on Deathstrike and Leech healing during that demonic build most Demon Hunters are playing now. Every time they Eye Beam, which is quite frequent, they will activate Metamorphosis, which causes all of their attacks to steal life from their opponents and self-sustain themselves. You pair that with a couple of Rejuvenations from Arresto Druid, and you've got a composition that's pretty much guaranteed to make it into deep dampening territory, and this is exactly what Neverlucky have crafted against a mage team, which makes sense. The mage does not have that self-sufficiency, and you will constantly tax Rub Cub's mana due to that fact, and Neverlucky have crafted this composition to really carry themselves through the rest of the tournament. I do expect to see this composition a lot in the upper bracket as well. This is something that Mez and Trill, I think, are likely to be running as well. When that composition goes head-to-head, I'm wondering what actually ends up happening in that particular situation, but right now, the rejects are just falling more and more behind. In deep dampening, they could go for a miracle one-hit wonder on Valido, but outside of that, they don't have any opportunities.
Yeah, Valido is getting a little bit low right now. Colo not having an opportunity to sit down for a drink. He's just trying to stop Rub Cub, and they're never lucky. They've been doing a good job in the matchup with that. Rub Cub actually sat down and got a huge drink there. So one blunder. Rub Cub's just been looking for drinks consistently throughout this matchup. Never Lucky shut down every single one, but just one opportunity to escape is a complete reset on Rub Cub's mana. And the rejects now are back in this, because as dampening gets higher and higher, the self-healing of Valido, the self-healing of Zac is going to be minimized, and that's an opportunity for the rejects to land a kill.
Colo looking to reset his mana here as well as this match extends itself into dampening. There is still that opportunity to just crush Valido through most of his defensive lineup in dampening, but they have brought a Demon Hunter, which brings the powerful cooldown Darkness, which places a purple cloud on the ground, and any player standing inside of that will have a chance to take zero damage from all attacks, a significant chance, upwards of 70% when talented. So that will be the cooldown that Zac needs to utilize to allow Valido to stay aggressive deeper into dampening and to start stabilizing the team. Now it's up to the rejects to try and bait that cooldown before a deep dampening point with a big push. So something like a touch of death within the next 25 to 30 seconds. Try to bait Zac into using a darkness. I think they need to combine it with Icy Veins. It has to be a huge hit. Then when touch of death rotates and is available again deeper into dampening, Seth Curry then can set up to kill Valido. This is the only win condition for the rejects. There's no margin for error. If they miss that one window, then Neverlucky will overwhelm them.
I like Valido playing Gnome in this matchup. The Escape Artist on a 1 minute cooldown is going to be a really nice way for him to get away from some of those roots as well as some of those Novas. And I think that's one thing that's not implemented by players enough, especially when they go after Frost Mages. It's a really good racial for making sure you can have high uptimes on targets that can root you and kite you.
All right, at this point, 20% dampening. I do want to see Jamili and Seth Curry look to set up something to bait that darkness from Zac. They've been holding on to these powerful cooldowns for some time. Jamili activating the first part of the attack with Frozen Orb, but not going all the way with Icy Veins, and I do not think they will need to respect this Frozen Orb. Ironbark trades more than effectively for it. Although Jamili is running that reduced cooldown on Frozen Orb every tick of Blizzard, a smart decision against an Unholy Death Knight who brings lots of ghouls to the battlefield and more targets to hit, so that Blizzard, as you can see it, reducing the cooldown of Frozen Orb so frequently. Now he will have Frozen Orb with no Ironbark, so Jamili has smartly created an opening here to now actually get the Icebound Fortitude from Valido, the anti-magic zone, but not the Darkness, and the Darkness is the most important cooldown. So Valido keeps it calm, cool, and collected, trades efficiently, and then continues to create this advantage that they've gotten from the start of the match.
Yep, Jamili now into a bash, forced into his first ice block. Not the best spot to be in at 25% dampening, but he does have one left. Rub Cub almost completely tapped on mana. They managed to get Ironbark and Ice Block in that last exchange, as well as Touch of Karma. So now Seth Curry could be a vulnerable target. I want to see Valido and Zac making sure they turn their attention onto Seth Curry, especially if he has no heal over time effects from Rub Cub. That's going to burn even more of Rub Cub's mana, and that really seems to be what they're going for in this game. They just want to run Rub Cub out of mana completely, and then eventually take down Jamili and Seth Curry when there's just really nothing left in the tank for them. Kolo still sitting very healthy on mana, sitting back, no crowd control initiated by the rejects. And I just don't see the rejects winning this game unless I can get crowd control on Kolo. He can just deal with this damage. And there's the second ice block. Things are falling apart for the rejects.
I mean, at this point, they don't have anything. Look at Rubcup's mana. It's completely zeroed out. There's no more ice blocks. There's no more Touch of Karma. Everybody on the rejects is dead. They need at least 40 more seconds for that window with Touch of Death. But that 40 seconds is something they are just not going to have the luxury to have. Rubcup locked down in a bash by Kolo as they engage to try and close the match. Seth Curry doing whatever he can with this Ring of Peace against the wall, allowing Jamili a little bit of space, but not enough with both members low on health. Rubcup can't get a drink to regenerate mana. There's nothing left cooldown-wise. The rejects have to go for the miracle kill. They need to just randomly pull a ton of burst out of nowhere because there's nothing left for them. Aggressively, Seth Curry gets caught into a fell eruption, and with nothing left in the tank, the rejects get stalled out into dampening in game one. Never lucky, look impenetrable. Rogue would actually be a good pick because you can negate all of his bleed damage over time effects, as well as the Maledict deep in dampening. And that's the biggest threat to the team of Never Lucky, is a Maledict all in at 50% dampening. So if Valido can just completely negate that with the Dark Iron Dwarf Racial, he takes that win condition entirely away. So maybe moving forward, if Valido goes down here, as he is playing Gnome again in game two, that could be an adaptation that they need to look for later on.
Yeah, we haven't seen any mages implement it yet, but I do think it's definitely something to consider early on. Zac and Valido taking quite a bit of damage. Kolo will trade out his Trinket and Ironbark. Actually gets caught out of form. Nice polymorph there by Jamili. Gets reversed magic by Zac, and that's one of the utility spells that the Demon Hunter brings to the table. Every 1 minute, he can reverse a magic effect off his team, and in this case, it was polymorph off Kolo. It dispels it, and that gives Kolo a lot more freedom in the matchup.
Yep, this composition is perfectly crafted to make a mage's life a living hell, so it's definitely
true that.
Well designed here by Never Lucky to take out Jamili's team, since Jamili is so pivotal on this roster. In the past, Jamili has multi-classed. He's played Shadow Priest in tournament setting, Enhancement Shaman, Elemental Shaman, and it may be the case that his mage needs to go to the bench and pick something else up against this composition. I'm not entirely sure what is the best option for him. I still think Arcane could make a late game push against this and kind of out attrition there his opponents, but as Frost, he's so limited and constantly pinned down, as we see an attack here by Never Lucky with those multiple Maledicts. Rubcup able to easily deflect, though. Well-timed dispels on that healing absorb. Never Lucky, though, just keeping up the chase and getting an ice block much earlier than last match. And the Windwalker does bring more defense to the mage. The Rogue brings more consistent pressure, and we're seeing the weakness in that trade show itself here now.
Well, what I think actually happened is Rubcup just said, I'm trading your block for mana. My mana is more important than your ice block. We're not going to die if I can heal you until either I'm out of mana or we're late into dampening, and neither of those win conditions are really there yet for Zac and Valido. So I actually kind of like that the rejects decided to do that. Rubcup just keeping his mana high. Jamili really unlikely to die until a little bit later on in the game, till either Rubcup is completely tapped on mana or dampening is just too high for him to heal.
I do like targeting Zac before dampening, trying to go after him as he is a lot less durable than the Unholy Death. And actually making a switch to Valido, trying to catch Kolo off guard with no life bloom. And that was a nice swap right when Kolo went for a drink. He can't refresh any heal over time effects, and they hit the target with less heal over time effects and created a huge pressure point, pulling multiple defensive cooldowns. And that is something that the rejects can look to do, is anytime Kolo sneaks away and drinks, make a swap to the other target with less heal over time effects and burst it down. That is one of the weaknesses of the Restoration Druid, and it's something that the rejects can exploit moving forward. They've created a good opening for themselves in that move.
Yeah, I think it's really intelligent, especially if Jamili's playing Kleptomania. Kolo runs away, you use the Kleptomania to remove all of those magic heal over time effects from a target. And that's when I want to see the Maledicts as well, really punish Valido and Zac, limit their self-healing in those situations where Kolo can't help them out or dispel the Maledict, and really force Kolo's hand to come back and help, because that's really the only threatening time in the game is with the Maledicts, with the Kleptomania, with offensive cooldowns. And I want to see them pull the trigger on those when Kolo is going away for drinks, like right now.
All right, in this opportunity, they could go aggressive, but Roasties is pinned down and unable to generate any sort of pressure. Tolvaron Arena going to be benefiting both sides when it comes to drinks, because it's such a huge map. We see Kolo trying to stop Rubcup and actually stopping him at least before a full reset on his mana bar. Fortunately, Innervate available for Rubcup, so all of his spells are free currently. Kolo actually denies the Innervate with a bash. well-timed there to try and still secure a significant mana lead in their favor. However, I feel like the mana advantage should be quite an easy victory for the team of Never Lucky. It's more of a matter of keeping Valido alive in deep dampening while they push for a kill. That's going to be where the difficult task comes in for Never Lucky. The rejects need to find opportunities by switching targets. They've actually got decent pressure here on both Valido and Zach. I think Roasty's assassination rogue aggressively is paying off.
Yeah, Valido does manage to use the anti-magic zone, but Jamilia has an opportunity now where Icy Veins will be available, and Valido will not have that anti-magic zone. Smoke Bomb gets dropped out by the rejects as they make a swap over to Zach. Can they take him down? If they can force out the darkness right now, that would be really big for the rejects, but it looks like Kolo's going to be able to heal through it as he waddles into the darkness to get in line of sight of Zach. Kolo's mana actually not doing great in this matchup. Rub Cub's ahead. I feel like Rub Cub's been able to escape, get the drinks more consistently. Kolo right now looking for a sip, but Roasty's going to shut that down as he chases Kolo behind the pillar. Kolo trinkets out of blind into a full bash. Will there be any follow-up? Crowd control doesn't look like it. Nice little offensive push here. On to Valido coming in from the rejects. But in the meantime, Jamili getting low. Rub Cub forced to trade out his Iron Bark. And right now, in terms of pressure, Never Lucky, they've had a few scary moments on them, but they're still feeling so safe. And Jamili just kind of traded out his Ice Block there. I think he would have been fine. He still had his Temporal Shield, but thought he was in trouble, traded it out, now won't have another Ice Block for another minute and a half.
I mean, there's more pressure in this game from both sides in terms of cooldown pressure. Rub Cub ahead on mana, which is unexpected. He's doing a much better job in this game over Kolo in terms of resetting that critical resource that is mana, the blue bar below his health. The higher that is, the more he has, and the longer he can extend the game, and that is the name of the game currently in the meta, is to drag the fight out into as deep of dampening as possible and execute for a bursty kill when the healer can simply no longer keep the team going. Jamili under pressure needs at least 49 more seconds to access another ice block to immune damage later on. Finally, some counter pressure here for the rejects towards Never Lucky, kind of crushing into Valido. If the rejects can maintain their mana and continue an attack like this later in the game, they do have opportunities to stay alive in the tournament, but if they can't, then Never Lucky are going to walk away with the series.
Yeah, Jamili gets interrupted, still a little bit low. 25 seconds, and then Jamili's going to be feeling healthy with another ice block available, and that's going to give Rub Cub a little bit of freedom to look for drinks as well. Can't let Jamili or Roasties fall behind. And what I want to see is Valido and Zach making sure Rub Cub's forced to keep hots on Roasties as well. Roasties is going to be on top of Jamili basically no matter what. The Death Knight and the Demon Hunter, all they have to do is tab target. They can keep up the pressure on Jamili with interrupts, but put some pressure on Roasties. Make sure you're attacking him so Rub Cub has to heal multiple pressure points.
Yep, Rub Cub is now equalizing with mana, but a counter spell. Jamili landed one earlier on and forced a lot. Let's see how much this one manages to net his team. And Icebound Fortitude is better than nothing. That is quite a powerful defensive cooldown there, and maybe a bit of a panic attack for the side of Never Lucky. There's decent pressure now onto Roasties. Kolo needs to try and sneak away and find an opportunity to reset his mana, but Rub Cub is moving over to deny that reset, and it's really just all about stopping the drinks. But Kolo managed to secure quite a significant lead right at a huge pressure point in the match. This is perfect timing for Never Lucky to make a push. Tons of damage, but Jamili's bought time to get this ice block that he needs to use basically immediately. Although before this ice block, Kolo's drink is what's going to secure his team the match. With multiple defensive cooldowns burned through for the rejects and a significant mana disadvantage, unless Rub Cub can sneak away and drink, it's going to be curtains for them. However, if he does try to do it, there's no defense to hold his team alive while he does. He can't leave the fight.
Yeah, Roast is getting low. It's asphyxiate on Rub Cub. He doesn't have a trinket. Roasties vanishes out of line of sight. Still getting targeted down by Zach. Iron Bark gets committed as well. This is what I want to see from Zach and Valido. Exactly what just happened. Now Roasties, no evasion, no cloak, no vanish, no nothing. When Rub Cub tries to get away, if he doesn't have hots on Roasties, he's going to be such a vulnerable target when he gets caught into the stun. If you look, Roasties has Vendetta coming up in around 20 seconds. He has Smoke Bomb. This is a minor opportunity here, potentially to go after Valido, who has no trinket. He has no Icebound Fortitude, and if they can get one solid crowd control chain on Kolo, get a nice Smoke Bomb on Valido, the rejects might be able to pull out this game.
Zach getting pressured here as the rejects mix it up and go after a different target. If they can manage to pull darkness during this attack, it would be pivotal for them to find victory, and they do. Zach has placed that purple cloud on the ground, which will save him here, but now 20% more dampening if Rub Cub can keep it up. That defense is gone, and that's the main defense for the team. Now it's out of the way. They're going to try and commit for the kill. They're going after Zach. I do not think think he should be the target later in the match, but for right now, at least, it's distracting Kolo and forcing him to expend a lot more mana. Potentially a swap to Valido soon could be opportunity, but they have to make it. Rustic gets stunned up. RubCup doesn't have many options. He's forced to use regrowth, but it's costing him so much mana, he can't afford to do it. He's trying to min-max healing without regrowth, but I don't know if he has enough healing per second to deal with it without using it. He's casting even more regrowth, taxing that mana further. Jamili has no ice blocks. There's really nothing left. Ironbark on 10% as Roasty's created an opportunity getting that darkness, but they're just unable to stabilize and counter-aggress to take advantage of it, and they're slowly getting overwhelmed.
RubCup is thirsty right now. Jamili getting lower, getting interrupted, and getting taken down. Never Lucky claiming game number two. The same strategy.
Large, but I don't think it's enough. They need pressure on the DPS. Seth needs to change his game plan. Don't go after Kolo at all. Put that pressure on Valido or Zac, and when you have that pressure, find the drinks.
I think your triangle used to be the other way around. Cleave comps used to beat Warlocks. Warlocks used to beat Mages, and Mages beat melee Cleaves. But since recent changes with the self-sufficiency of melee Cleaves, they can now out-heal the damage of the Mages and actually beat the Mages. The Warlocks now with Demon Armor can out-tank the melee Cleaves. So it's reversed the order, like the food chain that used to be there. It's now going in the opposite direction, and we're flowing upstream.
It's not a food pyramid. It's just a triangle of what beats what. It's like rock, paper, scissors, shoot. But right now, Rock is just shooting shots.
Rock can beat paper now. Paper beats scissors now, and scissors beats rock, basically. The triangle has been reversed.
Okay, I see what you're saying here. The only thing that has been reversed is who's getting revenge here, and it's going to be Kolo right now, unless the Rejects figure out something quickly.
Yeah, the Rejects have actually been playing this matchup much more aggressive very early on. Seth Curry looking for crowd control. RubCup followed it up, and it's a little bit of a different game plan. We saw on the Grand Arena, RubCup just running the entire game, looking for mana. Maybe he defaults back to that, but at least early on, the Rejects are looking to pull out some cooldowns and managed to find the anti-magic zone, but quite honestly, that's not a lot when you traded out your Icy Veins.
Yeah, and that's the trade Valido wants to make every time, so that's exactly what Never Lucky wants strategically. Any magic zone will always line up. Good swapping here by the Rejects going after Zac. I said that throughout the series, that switching targets against Restoration Druid is probably one of the only ways to get through their exorbitant amount of healing output. So in that opportunity, they tried to pull more cooldowns but didn't find it. If they can extend into dampening and have mana and make these swaps, then they're going to be able to net themselves kills. But now they're on match point. Jamili needs to win three in a row. This composition looked completely useless, in my opinion, in game number one against what Kolo has brought, and I'm very surprised that they went with it in game number three. I was really expecting a more significant change, maybe an Arcane Mage, maybe even RubCup on Paladin to try and bring extra damage. It seemed like RubCup last week, at least on Paladin, well, of course, Druid was outperforming Paladin overall. He was still at least going into Deep Dampening and going toe-to-toe, and that X factor of him on Paladin bringing some extra damage with that hammer down, it might be enough to take down a team, but he seems to just want to go with the safer pick, and they're just getting run over.
Yeah, Zac swapping over to RubCup, I think it's smart. Multiple pressure points is what Never Lucky wants to find in this matchup. Their objective is to tax RubCup's mana until he is completely out of it. And I think when Zac can move over, get the Fel Eruption, get the mana rift onto RubCup, it's just going to burn out that mana even quicker. But Kolo might have to actually look for an opportunity in this game to find some mana. Unfortunately, he hasn't really been able to sit down and drink. Seth Curry doing a better job making sure that Kolo's mana is in check, chasing him down right now. You can see creating a little bit of pressure, allowing Zac and Valido to rot down. But honestly, the Frostmage damage, the Frostmage rot from the Frozen Orb and Blizzard isn't going to be too significant. I think Valido and Zac will be able to heal through that damage.
Jamili is not playing, he's playing Freezing Rain now.
I think he's just trying to maximize his damage output, and I mean, it's paying off at least because Kolo's mana is more on parity with RubCup, so Jamili making some mid-series adaptations just in his talent selection to try and maximize his damage output just a tiny bit more to try and equal out the mana playing field for his team, but huge burst coming out by Zac. RubCup responds and trades, and now Seth Curry dishing out some pain towards Valido, forcing multiple cooldowns on that front. The Rejects are looking a lot better with this composition in Game 3, but I'm not totally sold yet.
They definitely have a lot more pressure in this matchup in particular. RubCup now using his Innervate, but bashed into a Mana Rift. He's going to be burning his mana, but the Innervate is going to be very important for both of these Restoration Druids. Innervate being a cooldown that allows all of the Restoration Druids spells to be basically free of charge, so he can use his really expensive heals, try to top off his team during that short window, and then have to play a little bit conservative once it's done. But things like spell stealing Kolo's Innervate are going to be crucial for Jamili to slow down the amount of output that he has and really not allow him to take advantage of that free mana.
Jamili slipping in a counter spell towards Kolo, but really nothing bouncing off the back end of that. Typically, counter spell is the playmaking ability for a mage against a Restoration Druid, as Polymorph is so difficult to secure, especially in the composition that Jamili is running. Typically, you'll rely on the Windwalker to set up that crowd control on Kolo with Paralysis, as it's just so taxing for the mage to even get close to the Druid and find a Polymorph with them shapeshifting and line of sighting them at the same time. So don't expect, you may be watching this as a mage saying, why isn't Jamili trying to Polymorph Kolo? It's just so difficult with the composition that he's facing that it's totally inefficient, and he's better off just maximizing his damage, which, of course, he can take advantage of against an Unholy Death Knight as they bring multiple pets into the arena, which are basically extra targets to hit with Blizzard, extra targets to hit with Frozen Orb to try and boost and increase Jamili's damage. So Jamili's main objective is to avoid as much damage as he can and deal as much damage as he can and sneak in counter spells, and in those counter spell windows, try and execute for kills. Now, of course, it's up to Kolo to avoid those counter spells. So keep your eyes open whenever there's a blue icon next to Kolo's health. That means that he has been counterspelled and can't heal, and that's when the rejects want to get going.
Yeah, Rev Cup looking for a drink once again to get shut down. Zach chasing him down, and the Demon Hunter is super strong. He can actually see where Rev Cup is in stealth with that Demon Sight, and that is one of the main strengths of a Demon Hunter in this matchup is, although they like to hunt demons, they can also hunt Resto Druids sitting down in stealth for mana. And I think shutting that down is really, really effective, and that's why we see Zach constantly chasing him.
All right, Zach, the target here for the rejects as they're mixing it up and trying to switch targets. This is a strategy that they've been building on throughout the series. It could be what they need to come back in this. Of course, Jamili does not want to lose to Kolo at any cost, but he's facing elimination from the tournament right now. And I will say, I want to compliment Valido. We often always focus on the popular players. Obviously, they're also very successful, but Valido is easily a top contender for one of the best Death Knights in the world, and he really does not get enough credit for it. He's kind of playing on these teams that maybe they don't have any streamer personalities on them, but he is kind of pioneered that Dark Simulacron. He's actually not running it in this series in particular, but he was the one that made other Death Knights start picking it up as well. So he's definitely a trendsetter. Pressure now for the rejects. Finally, Polymorph actually snuck in. Jamili manages to find it against one of the most difficult compositions to get it, and that's going to create a huge window for them, forcing Darkness, that critical cooldown from the Demon Hunter. That is basically a goal for the rejects throughout the entire fight. If they can pull it this early, now they have 3 minutes to execute for a kill.
Incapacitate onto Kolo, but unfortunately it was DR. I think Seth Curry should have been a little bit more patient with that. Maybe they feel like they had enough pressure. Kolo getting interrupted here. Jamili actually finding nice windows of opportunity with the Polymorph on Kolo. Another interrupt with Kleptomania, and Valido and Zach falling a little bit behind at 13% dampening. I think Kolo should be able to recover their HP, but you might have to start really considering sitting down for drinks. You can see Rub Cub right now in stealth looking for a little bit of mana and actually regenerated a lot. He's over 50% mana now. Kolo's already down to around 15, and the rejects are looking so much better in this game. Much cleaner gameplay.
Yeah, the mana management, the pressure, the cooldowns, the crowd control, everything about the rejects in game three is what I expect from Jamili, Seth Curry, and Rubka, but it might be two games too late. If they make one mistake, they're out of the tournament. They could not afford to just throw away two games playing half asleep. They need to get it together if they want to reverse sweep it. They finally got the good strategies. They're finding good opportunities. They've got a mana advantage and a cooldown advantage currently. If this was going to be the game for the rejects to bounce back, it's definitely it. Can they pull it off is now the question. They are getting into that deep dampening territory where they'll be able to punch through and kill Valido through those death strikes. They need to keep their eyes on Kolo. If he's able to sneak away and regenerate mana, that lead that they have will be lost. So watch for Kolo if he's going to be looking to retreat away from the fight.
Yeah, one of the things I like about the Windwalker Monk in this matchup over the Rogue is a lot more self-sustaining. We talked about the self-sustaining melee. Death Curry has a lot more self-healing for himself. He activates the Touch of Karma right now. And Rev Cub isn't going to have to worry about him as much as he would Roasties on the Rogue. Valido, ooh. Zach, still rotting down here. Seth Curry putting out some good pressure. Kolo's mana really not looking good.
Spell.
He gets interrupted. Nicely done by Jamili. Once again, looking for these windows of opportunity. Rev Cub goes for a drink. Unfortunately, not able to find it. And although RubCup got back to 60% mana, the amount of mana he's having to spend on Seth Curry, on Jamili, just so much higher than what Kolo's really having to deal with.
This is a big push for Seth Curry towards Zac. They've taxed Kolo out of mana, but Innervate just available. He needs to avoid being spell stolen on it. He gets crowd controlled by Seth Curry. They get spell stolen on. Jamili's trying to fish for it. He's not getting lucky on the spell steal. That Innervate is going to sit full duration. Kolo tops his team off with it. Pivotal for his team to regenerate and now go for a push because RubCup is equally taxed on mana. Dampening is hitting critical mass as this fight is likely to end soon. The Rejects had a lead for so long, they might be able to do it. Zac dips low and Jamili looking to bounce back into this. Maledix connects. No, Zac was able to avoid it. Switching to RubCup, somehow staying alive. He's kiting Seth Curry quite effectively. Zac was playing Paladin at a mastery we've never really seen to match RubCup. Now flipping over onto a Demon Hunter seemingly out of nowhere and managing to survive in that situation. That was the opportunity the Rejects spent the entire game setting up for, and it just slipped out of their fingers. Now Never Lucky have a massive advantage.
Yeah, Kolo sitting down for a drink. The Rejects, they have to shut this down. If Kolo gets a lot of mana here, it's going to be a nightmare. Seth Curry and RubCup realize it, chase him down, and I don't know if he was able to regenerate at all, much at all. RubCup's mana's doing decently well. Zac doing backflips in that last attempt by the Rejects, doing a really good job getting into the demon form and then going over to RubCup to attack him to get and take advantage of that Demon Hunter leech. So every time he attacks, he gets a little bit of his health back, which is super effective. Right now in dampening, it's not going to be nearly as effective as we've seen earlier on in the game, but Zac also got his darkness back, so major defensive cooldown still available for Neverlucky. Jamili Temporal Shield does get used. If they can force out the second Ice Block, this is going to be looking good. One Maledict incoming, a second Maledict, and there it is, the Ice Block. One thing I have to compliment Neverlucky on is they are doing a great job making sure they're not wasting their Maledicts. They use one, it gets dispelled. They use two more. It sounds simple, but a lot of teams aren't taking advantage of that, and Neverlucky definitely is.
Beautiful Ring of Peace onto this darkness, but Valido had Death's Advance, which makes him immune to knock. Back top level play there by Valido to make sure he stayed inside the defense of that darkness. He would otherwise be dead right now. Nice move, saving that cooldown to avoid the Ring of Peace. Valido starts to stabilize, but they've burned a lot of their defense. Both teams are running on fumes, but RubCup has the mana lead. He's done a more effective job than Kolo in this fight efficiently, and potentially that single-handedly could carry the team. He denies Kolo on his reset. If Neverlucky can't build momentum, they're looking like they're going to go down. Jamili launches an attack almost fully channeled Ray of Frost. Valido is pinned down at the pillar, desperately to stay out of line of sight of Icy Veins, but now they make a swap to Kolo. The Rejects have all the momentum. RubCup secures the lead for his team and potentially keeps his team in the tournament here. They're on match point. They face elimination. Can they take Kolo down in time?
I actually think going after Kolo is a waste of time in this part. He still had his Gladiator Self-Guard. He's Safeguard. He had his Bark Skin. Frenzied Regen is going to carry him through, and they could have dumped that damage on Valido, on Zac, and gotten a lot more
reverse
offensive cooldowns or potentially landed a kill. Now Jamili rotting down. Keep in mind, Jamili still no ice block for another minute and a half. RubCup is going to have to play catch up here. Good pressure still coming in from Valido, from Zac. Kolo commits the Iron Bark. That's the last line of defense he really has with that Innervate. And if he can spam out heals here, Seth Curry could be in some trouble. He gets gripped back. No touch of karma available for 15 seconds. Caught into the stun. If Valido can connect, Seth Curry could be in so much trouble. RubCup has to keep him alive for another 9 seconds. He ports away the Vivify spams. I think Seth Curry has done it. He's managed to weather the storm, but Neverlucky, they've managed to fully regenerate their health. Jamili's still in trouble. No ice block, getting low. Temporal Shield, Iron Bark, everything used by the Rejects to keep Jamili alive, but he could definitely fall in this moment.
Kolo is about to get his sweet, sweet revenge here in game number three, but Valido could fall in a cross kill. Seth Curry doing everything that he can. It's match point. They want to play this out to the absolute bitter end, but with the defense of Iron Bark, I think it's unlikely. There's maybe some hope here with Touch of Death about to explode, taking quite a huge chunk out of Valido's health. Seth Curry at 50% dampening with Chains of Ice just can't connect, and the victory is going to slip away for them, I do believe. Still crowd control on Kolo. No real defense with Death Pact and dampening not doing too much. They want to just play it out. I mean, a 50% healing reduction, I don't see why you wouldn't. Kolo completely tapped on mana, but if they can bring this back 2 versus 3, it would definitely be a miracle. I don't want to count them out just yet because we don't normally make it to a point in a fight like this. Kolo takes the opportunity to reset, get a drink. Valido's looking healthy. Rub Cub taps out. Never lucky. They get
feed versus the fake Zebras. We're all tied up. 1-1. Who is going to find themselves on match point? Who is going to get a little bit further into this tournament? Keep in mind, folks, we're doing a brand new thing. You have just entered, in the middle of history, the longest series that has ever been played in Battle for Azeroth.